spiritual world and the corporeal or physical world with human beings at their center. First of all, the substantial reality of these two worlds. The universe was created after the pattern of a human being who is in the image of God's dual characteristics. In other words, in the same way as man has a mind and a body, the universe consists of the incorporeal or internal spiritual world and the corporeal or physical world. Both worlds are real and substantial, and the two worlds together form the cosmos. In other words, in the same way as a human being exists with inner nature and outward shape, structure, and expression, outer form, and every form of life in the universe has inner character and outer form, the universe itself has an inner dimension, which is the spiritual dimension, and an external expression or form, which is the physical realm. Now, the incorporeal or spiritual world is in the position of subject partner, while the corporeal or physical world is the object partner. And the latter is an expression or even a shadow of the former. And that is why human beings, when we often in our dreams encounter a world that's more colorful and intense and real than our experience of our daily life, and in dreams we at times can receive guidance or awareness of something coming, or connection to our ancestors, etc. That's because the inner world of our human experience is actually more real, more essential, more substantial than the visible external world that we're used to. These together are the cosmos. Now, when we shed our physical bodies at the end of our life, we enter the incorporeal or spiritual world as spirits and live there for eternity. This is why in 1 Corinthians 15:44, Paul said, "It is sown a physical body and raised a spiritual body. If there is a physical body, there is also a spiritual body." Now, this suggests that the eternal spiritual body that we are meant to dwell in forever is not something given to us after we die based on our faith, but is part of our original structure and function. Yes, as the Bible says, man was formed out of the dust of the earth, and God breathed in the breath of life. That's our physical self formed from the development of the physical world over a process of time, and our spiritual self coming from God. And Ecclesiastes 12:7 says clearly, the dust or body returns to the earth from where it came, and the spirit returns to God who gave it. Then now let's consider the position of human beings in relationship to these two realms in the cosmos. We have our spiritual and physical selves. Let's consider the relationship between them and our position in the cosmos. First of all, human beings were created by God to be rulers of the universe, to have dominion over the creation. Secondly, human beings are to be the mediator and center of harmony connecting these two aspects of the cosmos. Think about it. Out of all of the physical beings in the universe, only one is self-aware, has an eternal nature, can connect to this, the meaning and value of life, and relate with the spiritual dimension. That's human beings. At the same time, out of all the spiritual beings in the universe, and the Bible mentions several, only one can reproduce children, develop our creativity and technology, and take rulership over this physical world. So human beings are the connecting point between the physical and spiritual realms. But this should not surprise us, because in fact, the physical and spiritual realms, the whole cosmos, was created by God as an environment for the joy of his children, in much the same way that a loving parent will prepare the baby room with a nice crib and toys, prepare the best environment that they can afford for their newborn children. Thirdly, human beings are the encapsulation in substantial form of the essence of everything in the cosmos. Our physical body is formed out of the material elements of the natural world. In fact, you are the most complete encapsulation of the universe that we know of. And it's for that reason that we have common elements with all things in creation. So we can relate to material and to animals and to the creation. The creation responds to the heart, love, and will of human beings. We can imitate animal sounds and understand and relate to the whole of the universe. At the same time, our spiritual self is made of all of the elements of the spiritual world. And therefore, we can say that both spiritually and physically, each person is a microcosm. And what that means is that you embody all of the creativity, the law, the principle, and divinity that is necessary to make the entire universe the same level of investment is existing to create one person. You as a human being truly have the value of the cosmos and are in that sense precious and valuable to God. Now, let's consider now the relationship, the reciprocal relationship between our physical and spiritual selves. First, the structure and function of our physical self. Within our physical self, we find two aspects. We consist of the dual characteristics of a physical mind and a physical body. Physical mind is our electrochemical brain that governs the survival instincts and functions of our physical body. Now, at the same time, the body is important because good or evil in our conduct, in the way we conduct our life, is in fact the main determinant of the growth of our spiritual self and whether the spirit self becomes good or bad. Good conduct, good habits lead to a good nature, a deeper heart, and a good person. However, bad habits and evil or destructive conduct corrupt our spiritual selves and lead to us becoming evil. Now, for those believers, faithful Christians, hearing this presentation, this does not mean that I'm suggesting that we are saved by our works. Rather, it means exactly what James wrote in the book of James, that our faith is expressed through our works, or that faith without works, as he said, is dead. James said, without your works, but I'm going to show you my faith through my works. In other words, if you happen to find one or two points inspirational from what is being shared in this presentation, sitting there watching the presentation, getting inspired, is not going to make you a better person. It's only when we stand up and act upon the values, ideals, and qualities that we learn that they become part of us. They become part of our spirit, our habit, our character, because our physical experience comes to us spiritually in the form of a vitality element. It's for this reason that Jesus said that when he returns, he's going to place the sheep on his right hand and the goats on his left and separate them by what? By how they've lived their lives. He'll say to the sheep, enter into the joy of my Father, and to the goats, depart into everlasting fire. Why? Based on this. Because when I was hungry, you fed me. When I was naked, you clothed me. When I was thirsty, you gave me drink. When I was sick, you cared for me. And you didn't do these things. And they'll say, when did we ever do this to you? And Jesus said, as you've done to the least of your brethren, so you've done to me. So our faith needs to be manifested in our actions in order that we can grow spiritually. Now let's consider the structure and function of our spiritual selves. As Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians, we have both. Sown a physical body, raised a spiritual body. If there is a physical body, there is also a spiritual body. Now, our spiritual self consists also of the dual characteristics of an inner nature, spiritual mind, and an outer form, spirit body. Our spiritual body is a body of energy that has the capacity to relate to the spiritual realm that surrounds us through our spiritual senses. Now, unfortunately, for most of us, being separated from God, as the Bible says, we are dimmed and darkened in our understanding, insensitive and unaware of our eternal existence and of the spiritual realm that surrounds us. That's true for most of us. Now, our spiritual mind is our inner self, the holy of holies, the most holy place, where as the that deep part within us where the Bible says that still small voice will speak to us. When God speaks to you, it will not be from the sky or from a burning bush, but from deep within us, because there is a whole other world to be accessed through our inner self that's more intense, meaningful, and substantial and real than even the environment that surrounds us. Now, we can say that the spirit can grow and reach perfection only while it abides in the flesh, because we need that element of our experience in order to grow. Therefore, the relationship between our physical and spiritual selves can be compared to that between a tree and its fruit. The tree or vine, rooted in the soil, gathers nourishment, and the fruit inherits its nourishment from the vine, like our spirit grows on the foundation of the depth of our heart and the growth of our experience in our physical lives. When the fruit is ripe, it is plucked for a greater purpose, like our spirit goes on. And the vine returns to the earth from where it came. We can also say that the spirit becomes good only through good actions in life that correspond to the standards, values, and faith that we receive from God. And also, the spirit becomes good only through the redemption of sins granted during earthly life. Think of the thief on the right hand of Jesus. While he was living a life of sin, surrounded by people just like himself, he could justify and not see anything different and couldn't easily change. But there on the cross, he encountered Jesus, who came from a place far beyond where he was at, and he could recognize, repent, and change. This is the value of our physical experience. So we have to then conclude that it is not God who ultimately decides whether a person's spirit enters heaven or hell upon their death. The ultimate destiny of our spiritual life is determined by the quality of our life on earth. Our spirit self determines our own destiny. This is why Jesus said that I leave the keys to the kingdom with you on earth. What you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. What you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. This introductory presentation on the principle of creation is only able to touch on a basic understanding of its content. There is much more. So I hope that you've got questions and curiosity and would like to study more. Please be sure to contact your local family federation and obtain a copy of The Divine Principle or study further in deeper lecture series. Thank you for your attention. God bless you.